Because now on Hot Copy, we have security analyst Chester Cabalza. Good morning, Chester.
Good morning, Kat. Thanks for having me.
All right, Chester, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. is expected to raise the West Philippine Sea issue during his state visit to China, but the Department of Foreign Affairs also says that the president's first state visit to China, his first state visit to a non-ASEAN country, is expected to set the tone of bilateral relations between Manila and Beijing. What kind of tone should the president set this time around?
Well, I agree with that kind of tone. It's going to be difficult because, of course, knowing that our president has been traveling around the ASEAN, the United Nations, and the European Union, which they called for multilateralism. And this would indicate China's stronghold for bilateralism in resolving the security anxiety in the West Philippine Sea. We should also consider that his upcoming visit to Beijing is also a call for a lot of reflections coming from the Philippines, because knowing that there are a lot of skirmishes in the South China Sea, and this will also prove the kind of diplomacy that the Philippines would want to have with China. The visit will also give our president the moment to think for his grand strategy on what kind of foreign policy he would want to have for the Philippines, on whether or not he will continue with the implementation of the neutrality policy, or would gain the fruits of his alliance with the United States or like-minded nations. We know for a fact that this is not going to be a walk in the park, but it would open a lot of confusion of quagmire, because we know for a fact that the strategic and political issue in the West Philippine Sea remains to be the gray zone in our relations with China. So it needs a lot of diplomatic skills and negotiation of what China wants for the Philippines and what Manila also wants for Beijing. So hopefully this peaceful resolution on the West Philippine Sea should be resolved, knowing that there are intentions of the joint exploration, and China knows our continuous bilateral relations with the United States.
Before we go on, before we delve into the joint exploration part, you spoke about the ability or the skill of the Philippines when it comes to negotiating with China. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. is bringing with him former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo, who China once described as a good friend of the Chinese people. How helpful or how significant would GMA's impact be on that negotiating table?
Well, we should consider that despite some loopholes during the Arroyo administration on our China bilateral relations, we know for a fact that President Gloria Arroyo could be an asset also, given that, of course, it started with her that our golden relations with Beijing happened. And because of that, she was very skillful in negotiating on our sovereignty and also on the issues on the West Philippine Sea. But of course, this would, during her time, would be different, because at the time there was no problem yet on the Scarborough Shoal, and of course with the swarming of the naval and maritime militia of China in the West Philippine Sea. So it needs a lot of skillful diplomacy, knowing that, of course, the part of diplomacy of President Arroyo is on economic diplomacy. We still need naval and maritime diplomacy on this matter, given that, of course, it's we are feeling a lot of pressures lately in our backyard in the West Philippine Sea.
Gloria Macapagal Arroyo, as we all know, has a background in economics. Would that also be helpful on the business front, on the investment front, on the side of negotiations there?
Yeah, definitely, because this gives the Philippines a head start for 2023, as President Bongbong Marcos, together with ex-president Gloria Arroyo and DFA Secretary Manolo, will go to Beijing. China is the world's second largest economy right now, and Asia's most powerful country. If they could negotiate well with the trade and economic interests of the Philippines, then that would also be good, because knowing that we know the projections for the economic performances of China, it is projected to be the largest economy by 2030 and beyond. So that means that that would only run for 8 years from now. So if they could negotiate well without, of course, sacrificing the sovereignty and territorial integrity of the Philippines, then that would be the best gift for 2023 for the Philippines.
Kind of a tricky situation right there, because President Ferdinand Marcos earlier said in previous interviews that the deadlock between the Philippines and China, between Manila and Beijing, actually stemmed from the fact that both countries could not agree on which constitution to follow. Are you more optimistic that that deadlock would finally be settled, especially when it comes to joint exploration projects in the West Philippine Sea?
That's right. That's the reason why we are encouraging the president to visit Beijing, because, of course, it will come into a full circle, knowing that we have already heard the American perspective, our European perspective this time around. Let's listen to the perspective of the Chinese on how they would deal with us on trade, diplomacy, and military issues. So we know for a fact that China could also deliver a lot in terms of their economic trade with us. So it's really a lot of a balancing act this time around, because we know for a fact that the only hindrance that we have with our bilateral relations with China would be our stand on the West Philippine Sea. So it's so hard, because we are not going to compromise the sovereignty of the Philippines, but at the same time, we need China, given that, of course, there are a lot of opportunities that China could offer for us, especially for the build better, more program, or the infrastructure program of this current administration.
Chester, in 2018, under the administration of President Rodrigo Duterte, the Philippines and China actually managed to sign a memorandum of agreement creating the Intergovernmental Joint Steering Committee, seen as the official negotiating forum when it comes to joint explorations in the West Philippine Sea. While that MOA was signed, it did not come into fruition, particularly because the Philippine side had to halt some of its activities in the West Philippine Sea after reports of Chinese vessels harassing survey vessels hired by service contractors from the side of the Philippines. What keeps you hopeful that there won't be a deja vu of this scenario this time around? What makes you say that negotiations under the Marcos administration would become more fruitful as compared to what happened with its predecessor?
Yeah, I agree. There was a meeting of the mind during the time of President Duterte, but this time around, we have learned about the tempo of China, especially on how they behave and think. And our relations with China has also evolved in terms of how we would study their temperaments and behaviors, knowing that we have also some territorial issues with them. Now, given that there is a continuing negotiations on the joint exploration, I think this time around there was even a pronouncement coming from the president that the Philippines can do it alone if in case it will not work with China. But I would recommend also that the joint exploration should be pursued, knowing that China could deliver a lot in terms of their technical and scientific endeavors. We also need some financial aspect on this one. I think the negotiation will push through this time around, because Beijing has high hopes for the administration of President Marcos. And also we will have President Arroyo, who will enlighten us on the economic front of this discussion with President Xi.
Chinese people are traditional in every sense of the word. How helpful would President Marcos's background be, taking into consideration that it was his father and namesake, former President Ferdinand Marcos Jr., who started bilateral ties with China during his presidential term decades ago? Would that also play a part in negotiations?
Definitely, Kat, because you know, during the time of President Marcos Sr., he has this policy, foreign policy on Asia for Asians. And I think the son, President Marcos Jr., is carrying the same mantra that, of course, the warm relations with Beijing will still continue, given that, of course, he has chosen to have his first non-ASEAN official visit to Beijing instead of going to China, to Washington. And I think this means a lot for China and for the Philippines, given that, of course, during the time when the Marcoses family were at their lowest point, China was there to support them. And I think this could also be a good leverage on how we would deal with our interests and also wants for China. And hopefully it will work this time around, because this is the best time for us to better view what China could also give to the Philippines. We have, I told you earlier, it will come into a full circle now, and the president will have to reflect after his visit to Beijing on what kind of foreign and security policies he wants for the Philippines this time around, on whether or not he will continue with that independent foreign policy. And of course, we should not also neglect our economic and trade diplomacy with China, because China is going to be an economic power in the future.
But you also mentioned earlier about China's tricky tempo when it comes to these dealings and negotiations. Mm. Would it be wise for the Philippines or for President Marcos Jr. to actually bring up the issue of rocket debris in the West Philippine Sea, another friction point between the two countries?
That is a courageous act that we will expect from President Marcos, because of course it concerns our national security problem. If that could be discussed then properly and diplomatically, then that's a plus for President Marcos. We should remember that that was also thing has been done also by President Duterte in the past, when he asked about discussions on the West Philippine Sea with President Xi. But the response he got from President Xi is that China would be preparing for war. We should also remember that in the previous post-autumn party congress, President Xi commanded the People's Liberation Army to prepare for war in case of skirmishes in the Taiwan Strait and also in the South China Sea. So meaning to say, it's going to be you need a lot of negotiating and diplomatic skill in the upcoming visit of President Marcos to Beijing, because of course we know response of China when it comes to their sovereignty issues. They are still considering bilateralism over multilateralism. So these are the things that we should consider during the visit. So it's really, it's not going to be a walk in the park, but we will see a lot of confusion of quagmire in the process.
Recent history would show that while negotiations on the diplomatic front are actually stable, the situation on the ground is a very different picture, shows a very right. different picture. Where and when should President Marcos draw the line? When should the president actually stop engaging in bilateral talks with China and instead pivot to a more international forum, similar to what former President Benigno Aquino III did way back in, I think, 2013, if I'm not mistaken? Or 2012, actually.
Right. That's in 2012, during this Scarborough Shoal. That is a very clever question. We should remember that President Marcos has an identity of his own. He wanted to replicate what his father has done so far, but I think this time around we wanted to see what kind of leadership he wanted to show. And these are some of the things that I could see. We should remember that time will come that the Philippines will have to choose. Although it's a sad thing for us, but given that, of course, in a multipolar world, especially in our backyard, where you have a very competitive superpowers trying to get our attention, we cannot afford to have that neutrality policy until 2028. I mean to say that we will have to choose by the time that we are ready, once we have reflected of what kind of foreign and security policy that we wanted for our country. Secondly, although it's going to be a very discerning decision coming from President Marcos, knowing that his balancing act or neutrality policy will is going to be more expensive, knowing that of course there is a strict competition coming from these two superpowers. I think the best remedy would, of course, to strengthen still our armed forces. That's the only thing that we can redeem ourselves to, not so much depend with the superpowers. And thirdly, I think the most important, of course, is to invest much on our economy. Multilateralism works in many ways. We're not Vietnam, although Vietnam has been performing so far in terms of how they are dealing with China lately. But the problem with Vietnam is that they don't have the United States or treaty ally with the United States. That's the difference of Vietnam to the Philippines. That's the reason why it's very tricky for us on how to deal with China right now, because we have a standing treaty ally with the United States. And at the same time, China wants to consider us as their strategic partner. And China is supposed to be the largest economy in the world in the future. So we have to really define what kind of foreign policy and security policy that we wanted for the Philippines.
The Philippines clearly at a crossroads now in terms of its bilateral relations with China. Thank you so much for sharing your insights, Chester Cabalza.